My hope is built on nothing less. That's our congregational, the opening congregational song. It's 104 in our yellow hymn books. 104 in our yellow hymn books.
For us, may we hear you speak. We don't want to hear the words of man, but we want to hear from you, Father. Amen. Anoint your word this morning, Father, and we live all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We'll welcome you once more to the house of God, and we thank God for opening up our churches, although the numbers are still low. Only 50 are expected to gather by the authorities. We hope very soon we will all be able to come physically in church. We really encourage those who are at home joining us through Zoom and YouTube to take advantage of Sunday worship and make sure you set aside that day to worship God.
Amen.
This also goes for our midweek services. Brethren, where possible, let's not stay at home. As God must help us, that those who are near, like here in Heathcliff, please make sure that this house is opened on Tuesdays. I think the time is still 5 o'clock. Is that a change?
Yes.
Here they meet on 5 o'clock on Tuesdays and 5 o'clock on Fridays, so that people disperse while it's still, not late. This is why that time was chosen. But let's take advantage of that and make sure that we come and attend our midweek services. The Zoom services also will continue Tuesday and Fridays at 6:30, 6:30. And on Wednesday, 6:30 is our Bible study. Let's make a date with those days. When I sit down, we are going to have another congregational song and to be followed by our scripture reading, which also will be in English. I hope we all have our Bibles, those who are having Shona Bibles, and then we'll go, we'll have our last special, then followed by the Word of God. This is our only service for today. We don't have an afternoon service. God bless you.
Count your blessings. Hymn 154 in our yellow hymn books. Hymn 154 in our green hymn books. 516. Count your blessings.
Namo te pasi tika kutabuta no kutama kokana kukurasa onama kuburiru averege ujashane fane zito zase averege makumore Averenge mazita au Averenge maropa fatu Uta chami zwaneze ito zase Uno muto rowe zisito ere Chiji kwa uno kure mera iri Berengaji natu na mutoroba Utai mamazuwa achi kura Ali rengi mako morero Ali rengi mazita au Ali rengi maropa fazo Uta chami swaneje ito zase Umatambu zoma kuru maduku Usatamwe are mapsuru mari Berengashi natsu uta yaratwa Lemurwe nurwose uta yamurwa Ave renge mako morero Ave renge mazita au Ave renge maro papato Ocha chami swaneji ito chase
Scripture reading is taken from Philippians 4, verse 8. Philippians chapter 4, reading from verse 8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things.
Speak the
Let's turn our Bibles to Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. God helping us. We are going to talk today about making godly decisions. We had a wonderful Sunday school lesson which was directing us and showing us how to maintain our purity as Christians. We want to thank God that our God is represented in holiness. Amen. And He requires us to be pure, not only in our thoughts, but also in our lives. Amen. Because what we think and whatever is within us, God sees. But what we do and what we say, the world sees. It hears as well. So if anyone were to give a report, they would base their evidence on what they see of us and what they hear of us. But God does not base His judgment on what people see. He does not base His judgment on people's feelings as well. He knows the intents of our hearts. Therefore, when we are looking at the Word of God, let us be careful to know that whatever decisions or whatever choices we are making, those choices, God knows them. Therefore, this morning, we are going to consider making godly choices, because that will guarantee us eternal life. If we make the wrong choices, our end is damnation. We know that there is the broad way. Many are walking in it. There is also the narrow way. We are here being limited to 50. But I believe those who are in the media, you also can join us in the narrow way. We have come to church and we've been limited to 50 because the requirements, there are certain requirements that have been put for us. Where we are going to heaven, God has also put requirements. And those requirements are going to limit the number of people who are going to get there. We may also have been born like any other people here on earth. We may enjoy life like other people and have the hope of making eternal life. But what will determine our end is following what God says we must do. So in the verse that we have just read in our scripture reading, which was Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, you know, it was telling us a basis of godly choices. That whatsoever is true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Amen. I'm sure those who are teachers would say that's a good syllabus. Yes. Amen. That's a good syllabus. Amen. We can say, if God were to help us as people who are born again, and we make it a point that what the Word of God is telling us to do, we do it. Surely, we know there are first classes in heaven as well. Amen. God can say, well done, yes, thou good and faithful servant. Yes.
Because you will have followed God's requirement. You will have done the will of God. So in order to do the will of God, you must be led by a godly choice. Because every time we are faced with choices, a choice to follow the broad way or the narrow way, a choice to follow the kingdom of light or the kingdom of darkness, a choice to listen to the devil or a choice to listen to God, a choice, you know, to be a saint or a choice to be a sinner. You have to make a choice whether you want to be a saint whilst you are here, or also choose that you want to be a sinner. If you are idle and you do not make any choices, you will be a sinner anyway. Those who not choose will remain sinners because we are born sinners. But if you are choosing to change from your state to something that is pleasing to God, that is a godly choice.
Amen.
And that is the first choice each and every one of us must make. The Bible tells us that even as we grow up, you know, our first priority should be to seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness. So whatever choices we may make and evaluate, these will follow. Let's read in Psalms chapter 37, verse 23. Psalm 37, verse 23. It reads, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way." The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. So when you seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, it means automatically you have put yourself under God's leadership and direction. Because of our own, we cannot make any godly choice. We are born sinners. Therefore, our choices, whether we like it or not, are evil. You know, our condition as we are born, irrespective of the family you are born from, even the family of a minister of religion or a priest, you are a sinner by birth. If you are born by a drunkard, you are a sinner by birth. But God requires that each and every one of us should make a choice. And that first choice is to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all the other things that we want in this life, God says they will follow. God will order our steps. He knows what comes first. He knows what follows. And what we should do is simply put ourselves in his hands. And the Bible tells us that when we are saved, we are actually made servants of righteousness. We have no choice. You know, when someone is your servant, you tell them what to do. You say, go and fetch water, they will go and fetch water for you. Go and dig in my garden, they will go and dig for you. Do this, they will follow the instructions. When we are saved, God makes us his children. And we have no other choice other than to listen to what God tells us to do. During our Sunday school class, you know, I was excited when I heard one of the young men saying, you know, salvation puts Christ in our lives and he tells us what to do. Therefore, when you are living, it's not about you, it's about Christ.
Amen.
Your life is Christ-like. God is giving the direction. He is telling you what to say. He is telling you what to think. David says, if I consider iniquity in my heart, God will not hear me. So God is even worried about what you think. When you are quiet and everybody says, it's fine, but God sees inside us. We read in Ezekiel chapter 36. Let's read from verse 26. Ezekiel 36 from verse 26. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. We want to thank God because he is the originator and facilitator of godly decisions. Godly decisions don't come from us. God himself is the author. God himself is the director. All that you and I have to do is let God do his work in you. Let God be the driver. Let him take charge. Let him tell you what to do. Even if you are at crossroads, let God tell you what to do.
Amen.
Don't depend upon your intellect. Don't depend upon your feelings. Are you a young man? God knows when you should marry. Are you a young lady? God knows when you should marry. And he even knows whether it's his will for you to be married. Because those who are married are only married for a season. But we are going to live forever when we have left this life.
Amen.
After this life, whether you were married or not married, it's not going to make a difference. You will probably be married for 50 years, for 70 years, for 40 years, or whatever. And it will end there. Yesterday we had a wedding. You know, the couple there made pledges. But something was mentioned that till death parts us. In other words, death is the end of everything that we make here. All the decisions that we make and are to do with this life will end when we die. But we want to thank God that we can make decisions for eternity.
Amen.
And those decisions for eternity can be made now.
Amen.
Not tomorrow. And when we make those godly decisions, God has given us a timeline to make those decisions. In the Bible, we read about two men. One was a rich man, and another one was a poor man called Lazarus. These people were given an opportunity to make some decisions. And the major difference between them is that the rich man did not make a decision to seek God. He made decisions to gratify himself whilst he was here on earth. But after life ended, that was the end. Lazarus, on the other hand, has had a lot of problems in his life, but thank God he made one decision. And that decision was a very worthwhile decision. It was a decision to be, you know, faithful to God. He made a choice to please God. You cannot sleep on Delilah, sleep, relapse, you know, you know, young people, and then expect to wake up on Abraham's bosom. No. Where you sleep is where you wake up. If you die a sinner, you will go to hell. If you die a saint, you will go to heaven. The state in which you are today determines the state in which you will be tomorrow. God is merciful, and we want to thank God that during this time, we are in the dispensation of mercy. This is the dispensation of grace. God has given us a big window to make godly decisions. And those decisions can help us to make heaven our home. We want to thank God that, you know, God is so merciful. He gives us time to introspect. You know, we actually see that when you are making these decisions and you are relying on God, you will never go wrong. And decisions that we make, even in this life, they are affected by our age. Sometimes you look at the person, you know, sometimes you see children playing on the road and the ball, you know, strays into the highway. And you see a small child running to pick the ball when there is oncoming traffic. They just rush there. And to a small child, the ball is more important than their life. And someone has to put on hard brakes to avoid the child because they've made the wrong choice. They decided they wanted to pick the ball. But in our own spiritual walk with God, let's ask God that He gives us spiritual food. And we want to thank God that the Sunday school classes that we are having are giving us nourishment so that we are growing. And the sign of growth is seen when we make godly decisions. Decisions that affect our lives. Decisions that will propel us to the future that has got hope. So we know that these decisions that are godly, they are also driven by faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Those that come to God must believe that He is. And when you say faith, it is the substance of godly things. Not, you know, those things that we hope for. It's not, you know, like if you are, some people want to say, you know, I have faith because I know I'm going to have a car, I'm going to have a beautiful wife, I'm going to have, I'm working, I'm going to have a good education. Yes, you know, it helps you to keep on going. But God help us to have something further than the temporal affairs of this earth. We want faith that is able to show us the evidence of godly things hoped for. Godly promises that God has given us. Godly choices that God has made. So that when you are living, either as a young man, or a young lady, or a married man, or whatever you are, put God first.
Amen.
Let God make the decision for you. Irrespective of your situation, let God make the decision for you. In our text, we are going to read about some people who also were in our position. We have been learning about Daniel. That Daniel was taken to Babylon. When we were reading that book of Jeremiah, not much was said about Daniel. But we know that Daniel did something. He obeyed what the prophet Jeremiah was saying. The message that Jeremiah was preaching Daniel believed that. When Jeremiah was saying, go to Babylon, don't resist, don't do this, please be obedient. Daniel said, yes, it's fine, let's go. Let's go. He might have been encouraging even, you know, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to say, look, this is God's plan. Let's follow it. And when they got there, they were chosen, among others, in Babylon to say, these are fine young men. There's a lot of potential in them. And they were, you know, taken close to the king. They were given a special diet according to the king, something that was very peculiar. But we want to thank God that Daniel made a godly decision. In verse 8 of chapter 1 of Daniel, we are told that Daniel purposed in his heart. He made a choice in his heart. Let's read. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. You know, as Christians, you and I have to make personal choices.
Amen.
We have to make those choices as individuals. We thank God if we are a group, as a church, and we also are in that decision, God will bless us.
Amen.
But it starts with you, and it starts with me. And when Daniel made that decision, we know that there was Meshach. There was Ananias and Mishael and Azariah. Those were the names that they had. The other three boys that were with Daniel. Let's read Daniel chapter 1, verse 6, just to confirm. Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Ananias, Mishael, and Azariah. Let's just read to see what type of people these were. Verse 4. Children in whom was no blemish, and well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's place, whom they might teach the learning and the tongues of the Chaldeans. These were specifically chosen because there was something special in them. But we want to thank God that whatever was seen was not made by these three boys. God put it there. God deposited these qualities in these people. And the same God can deposit these qualities within us.
Amen.
As we are living in this world, for us to make godly decisions, God has to put his spirit within us. He has to direct us. And when it came to decision time, it was very difficult for the junior officer there to make a decision which was against the king. But you see, the way Daniel talked to him was so persuasive. Let's read verse 12 of Daniel chapter 1. Prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days. Let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. As for these four children, Verse 17, as for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. We want to notice that God gave them. God gave them.
Amen.
God can give you.
Amen.
What you need in order to make a godly choice, ask God to give you. The Bible says, ask and you shall be given. Seek and you shall find. God gave them. One thing that I like about God-given things is no one can take them away from you. If God gives you something, it's God-given. No one can take it away from you because it's God-given. So if God gives wisdom, that wisdom will take you to eternity. If you get the wisdom from the world, it will assist you here, but when you live here, that's the end. But we want to get godly wisdom. And this godly wisdom is what Daniel got and was shared with his friends. Verse 20 we shall read. And in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all his realm. These days there are magicians, there are astrologers as well. You may say that we don't have magicians. This Zimbabwe is full of magicians. The world is full of magicians. It's full of people who say they are wise. It's full of people who have got devices. But God has called us today.
Amen.
And wherever we are, God is looking for people that he can put his own wisdom in.
Amen.
People who will make godly decisions because they are in tune with God. And we can see that he said, give us 10 days. And during those 10 days, the gap that was shown between these ordinary people of the world and them was 10 times. I know young people, sometimes you ask yourself, sometimes you think you are wasting your time when you go to church. You think, you know, you could have been doing something worth the while. But I can tell you, as simple as it is, they were eating pulse and drinking water. Pulse was to keep them going. Those who talk about nourishment, yes, it was God-given nourishment. Pulse is something which God put himself at creation. And the drinking water, water is God made. They said, we will eat this. It will make us survive. But after 10 days, you must look at the difference.
Amen.
When you listen to the word of God and follow it, there will be a difference in your life.
Amen.
10 days is not a long time. When you are saved, you don't take 10 days for people to notice that you are different. When a person is in Christ, they are a new creature.
Amen.
Old things are passed away. You are given a new identity.
Amen.
And your godly decisions are immediate. They are not gradual. Yes, you can grow in godliness. That will improve your decision making. But being a child of God brings about a total transformation. And may God help us, that as we check ourselves, let us be sure that we are transformed. That we are not living like the world. That God has changed our lives. Because the opportunity is here. So we said, by faith, decisions can be made. And those decisions improve when you grow in faith. Paul says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. There should be spiritual growth. In our godly decisions, we should show decisions of Christian maturity. Amen. Our brother was talking about the situation that we are living in now under COVID conditions. Some are no longer going to church, yes, physically. But we want to thank God that the Bible says, men shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from God. You can open the Bible and God can talk to you. Whether you are in the confines of your home, whether you have come to church and you are enjoying fellowship, what matters is not just the fellowship of saying, how are you, my brother? How is your family? And what have you? What matters is what you are taking from the Word of God. Because that is something that will keep you for eternity. Our Lord Jesus Christ visited Mary and Martha in their home. It was important for them to eat. Martha said, look, Jesus is coming and we have to prepare, you know, a delicious meal. Jesus is coming, let's have a good meal. He should enjoy himself. And she was busy preparing a delicious meal. But while she was doing that, while she had made that decision, she thought Mary should have made the same decision. But Mary had a different set of, you know, ideas. Mary considered eternity. Mary knew that she didn't know how long she was going to last. She didn't know how many days were left for her. She didn't know whether she was even going to eat that meal. She didn't know what was awaiting her. And she said, if the Lord has come, let me go and listen to him. Let me go and hear the word that God has for me. And Mary made a choice to say, let me sit at the feet of Jesus and learn. And out of the two sisters, Jesus found an opportunity to give us a lesson. To say, only one thing matters. Let us not worry about so many things. When it comes to making godly decisions, one thing matters. There are not so many things that should really encumber us, and it's not complicated. Trust God. Amen. Trust Him. Amen. Do not be careful for nothing. Let God make the decisions that you are supposed to make. Let God give you the choices. And we want to thank God that, you know, the decision that Mary made was praised by Jesus. Amen. Jesus said, she has made a wise decision. Everything that you have been laboring for, you know, food, when we eat it, no matter, you know, yesterday we were at the wedding, I can't talk about the food that we ate there because that finished. And by the 2 days, 3 days, once it's in the tummy, we don't even know how it tasted. Whether it was bad, whether it was good, in the tummy, that's it, it's gone. But we want to thank God that the word of God is the incorruptible seed of God. Amen. when you take it in your soul, it's the living word that will take you to eternity. And may God help us in our making godly decisions. They must be word-based decisions. They must be decisions that God can command. If you are going to mark the textbook of your choices, God would say, yes, that's correct. Yes, that's correct. Yes, that's correct. And God can say, yes, I love that. That's wonderful. But sometimes God looks at our choices. We give him our choices. We say, God, these are my choices. Mark them. God says it's wrong. This one is because you are lustful. You love what is beyond you. This is envious. This decision is wrong because it's sinful. But this morning, God help us.
Amen.
That when we are making our decisions, let God be the guide.
Amen.
Let God show us the way. We have in the Bible, Abel and Cain. They made choices. It was time to go for sacrifices. Let's just read the verse. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he was obtained, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh. You know, Abel had an opportunity to make a sacrifice, and we want to thank God that when he made his sacrifice, it was not a sacrifice that he brought out of his wisdom. God had a way that was spelled out. And when Abel made his decision, it was a faith-based choice. It was a faith-based choice, based on the word of God, based on the direction of God, based on prayer. And when he made that decision, it pleased God. But Cain made the decision out of the labor that he had, made. Everything looked fine to him. Everything looked very excellent to him. But God was not pleased, because he substituted God's will for his own. So when we make our decisions, they must be based on humility. Let God decide what we are supposed to do. Don't make the decision without considering God's perspective. We are led by choices every day. We are told in the word of God. And what choices we make, they actually determine our future. Let's look at the book of Job, chapter 23. Verse 10 to 12. Job chapter 23, verse 10 to 12. But he knoweth the way that I take.
Amen.
When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot hath held his steps, his way have I kept,
Amen.
And not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandments of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. If we were given, you know, to make a choice, to say, can you choose the way that Job took? Not many of us would volunteer and say, Lord, I want to live like Job lived. But in your life, God has put choices. And Job is telling us here that he knew in his heart that God himself knew the way that he was taking. God knew from where to where he was taking Job. He didn't understand much of the things around him, but he was confident that God knew what was best for him. Amen. Even when he was having trials, hard trials, you know, and difficult times, Job would say, God knows better.
Amen.
His wife said, look, curse God, because the situation you are in is hopeless. But Job was able to withstand his wife and say, honey, we can't be receiving good things from God all the time. There are bad things that come as well. And when they come, it was as if the word of God was telling Job that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord. I don't know what this trial is for me. Because after a trial, there is promotion. If you are an overcomer, if you have a hard situation and you have overcome that hard situation, God will promote you.
Amen.
You will not be the same. Look at Daniel. After he came out from the lion's den, look at the three Hebrew boys after they had been taken out of the fire. They were not the same.
Amen.
They were promoted. When you overcome, God will automatically promote you.
Amen.
You will not be the same person.
Amen.
So when a trial comes, when a hard situation comes, it's your testing time.
Yes.
And may God give you the grace to make a godly decision.
Amen.
Don't make a decision based on your feeling. Job said, I have esteemed the word of his mouth more than my necessary food.
Amen.
I don't place much importance on my food. It was as if he had listened to the sermon from Jesus.
Amen.
To the people who were following him.
Amen.
When he said, look, you people are following me because I gave you food, I gave you bread. Some were following him because they knew of the miracles he made at the marriage, you know, time when they at Cana of Galilee, where he actually changed the wine, the water to wine. And they said, look, this man can be king. If we were to be liberated from the Romans who are taking, you know, who are taking taxes from us, who are making us servants, and Jesus becomes our king, when we want bread, Jesus will give us bread. When there's no wine, Jesus will give us wine. And Jesus said, look, if you are following me because of these things, you are really pitiful people. Paul looked at the same situation and said, your decisions should not be based upon these things. Your decisions should be based upon something of more value.
Amen.
And in order for you to make a godly decision, use faith.
Amen.
Faith will take you from one level to the other.
Amen.
We want to thank God because in the Bible we are told that Orpah and Ruth made decisions. Both had lost their husbands. Both were from Moab. Their husbands were of Jewish origin, but they died, and they were left with Naomi, their mother-in-law. And Naomi made a decision. She said, I hear there's plenty now back home. I'm going back home. You too. You are free to make your decisions. Here in Moab, you can get remarried and life can go on. You are used to the Moabites, they are your people. I'm going back to the land of Israel. I have to go back. I have roots there. But you don't have roots there. Stay here. And Opa made a decision to go back. She thought it was a reasonable decision because it was justified by the circumstances. But Ruth, because of faith,
amen,
had a different mindset.
Yeah.
And let's just read what Ruth said.
Amen.
You know, that should help us when we are making decisions.
Amen.
Ruth, in her heart, she had a commitment. Ruth chapter 1 from verse 15 to 17. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go.
Amen.
And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God.
Amen.
And where thou diest, I will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. Yes, we know the decision that Ruth made. According to her, it was a decision she made while she was here on earth. But we want to thank God that she made that decision here on earth, but it had the potential to take her to heaven.
Amen.
If Ruth was going to go to heaven and Naomi was going to go to heaven, both Ruth and Naomi would end up in heaven because that was a godly decision. She made a godly decision to say, I am leaving Moab. In Moab, they follow these idols. In Moab, they do not have commitment to the word of God. But I am making a choice that I'm going with Naomi. And where Naomi will be, there is the word of God there.
Amen.
Where Naomi is, there is something that will be of eternal value to me. And when they reached there, sure, she found favor in the sight of God.
Amen.
When you make a godly decision, God's favor is on your side.
Hallelujah.
Things will change. No matter what the circumstances may be around you, as long as you have made a godly decision, a choice for God, God will be with you.
Amen.
So you and I have got a responsibility to be on God's side.
Amen.
Let's make a choice that pleases God.
Amen.
And after making that choice, the rest is God's business. We know of Moses, we were told about Moses' decision. That when he was old, he made a decision. He said, I was brought up by Pharaoh's daughter. I've enjoyed the pleasure of Egypt, but enough is enough. I'm making a decision.
Amen.
This decision may not please me because I'm going to lose a lot of privileges that are associated with being Pharaoh's daughter. But the people who are calling me Pharaoh's daughter don't know the truth. They don't know that I am a Jew. I have to come out in the open.
Yes.
I have to tell them.
Hallelujah.
If you are a Christian, come out in the open.
Amen.
Tell the world that you are a Christian. Don't leave people doubting as to where you stand. Tell the world where you stand.
Amen.
Tell the world who you are.
Amen.
And when you make your godly choice, people will know that you are different. And we want to thank God because he is able to vindicate his own. When you fear God, the fear of God will drive your decisions. If you are making a godly decision, it's because you fear God. You don't fear man. You put God in his rightful position, and you put men in their rightful positions. And when you do that, God will help you. We know of the experience that Abraham had and Lot. They had to make decisions. Lot looked at the, you know, plains of Moab. There was much that was desirable to the human eye. But we want to thank God. Let's read Genesis. Let's just read Genesis and see how God helped Abraham in his decision making. Genesis chapter 13 from verse 7 to 10. We read, and there was strife between the headmen of Abraham's cattle and the headmen of Lot's cattle, and the Canaanites and the Perizzites dwelled then in the land. And Abraham said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my headmen and thy headmen, for we be brethren. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. And if thou depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan. And there it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest unto Zoar. Let's read from verse 10. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere, before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, and even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt. Verse 11. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves from one from the other. And Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent towards Sodom. But the men of Sodom were wicked and sinners before the Lord exceedingly. And the Lord said unto Abraham, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art, northward and southward and eastward and westward. You know, I like this.
Amen.
I like this.
Amen.
I like this. Because God gave him all the directions. You know, when we are making our decisions, let us know why we are making those decisions. Ask yourself, why am I making this decision? Because without God, you can do nothing. But with God, you can do all things. Paul says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. If your strength is coming from God, then you can go. But if your strength is coming from something else, then you are doomed to fail. But may God help us.
Amen.
We know that there is, you know, a decision that you need to make. There are decisions I need to make. There are choices that we have to make. But let our choices be godly.
Amen.
Let God come in and say, yes, I'm pleased. We know with our Lord Jesus Christ, God himself said, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. May God be well pleased in us.
Amen.
Whatever we do, may God say yes, that is the way it should be.
Amen.
Those godly decisions can only come because we are humble. We are seeking direction. We know Abraham, when he made that decision, it was with God's blessing. Noah made that decision. Lot made that decision, but it was not with God's blessing. Destruction was there. The wicked people were there. You know, he had to run away from Sodom and Gomorrah, and it didn't take much with him. Lot's wife failed because that decision had consequences. Because after they settled, wherever they settled there, she became attached with the things that were happening there. And even when God had made a plan to take them out, her heart was still stuck with things that were there. And in the New Testament, we are reminded, remember Lot's wife. And when the Bible says, remember Lot's wife, it's a summary of her life. It's a summary of the decisions she made that were contrary to what God wanted. Decisions that would have, you know, when she had all the opportunity. Because she actually came out of Sodom and Gomorrah. She had every good opportunity. We have come out from the world. You know, for us to be here is a declaration that we have left the world. But we were just being told by the lesson this morning, that we should watch ourselves because pollution is still there.
Yeah.
You may be in the world, but you should not be of the world.
Yeah.
You may be, yes, like everybody else, you look alike. But you shouldn't be alike inside. Because you have got the kingdom of God in your heart. Whatever you are doing, you are a representative of God. God has got trust in you. I'm thankful to God that, you know, God has put boundaries. He doesn't say that a man's decision will bind his wife, and the wife's decision will bind. When it comes to God, you stand on your own. There are no families. You make your own decision. And when you make your decision, you stand by it to eternity. You may be hated. You may be lonely. You may, whatever, have a position where no one can say you are right. But as long as God says you are right, you are really right. If God says you are wrong, even if the whole world says you are right, you are wrong. The whole world may say you are right. But when God says you are wrong, then definitely you don't have it. So may God help us.
Amen.
In the depths of our hearts, may we have the implant of God's word, so that when we make decisions, God is pleased with us.
Amen.
God is saying, you know, you have an opportunity. We have come for this message. God has got something for you.
Amen.
He says, I've got good plans for you.
Amen.
Plans to give you your expected end. But you have your own choices to make. You have your own decisions to make. All of the people that we were talking about, they were exposed to the word of God, but they made choices. And we know the Bible tells us about Joshua. He also made a decision. He says, as for me,
Amen.
As for me, Joshua,
Amen.
And my house, me and my house, it starts with you.
Amen.
You have to stand alone and say, me.
Amen.
Don't look at the other people. It's
Amen.
About you.
Amen.
Because when you die alone. And when you stand before God, you stand alone. You are accountable to God as an individual. Some say my husband is backslidden. It's not about your husband. You know, when Lot realized that his wife had turned, you know, I mean, he didn't even know that the wife had turned into a pillar of salt. Because he never had a chance to look forward. He was ahead there. The wife was following. When she turned into a pillar of salt, he didn't look back. He kept on going. He didn't hear the footsteps of the wife. And that didn't worry him. He said, I'm worried about my own survival. I have to get to the destination. May God help us. That when we are listening to God and making godly choices, stand alone.
Amen.
Don't stand in a crowd. Don't say we. It doesn't work before God. Adam tried it. It never worked. To say the wife you gave me. It's not about the wife given by God. It's about you. And it's not about the husband given by God. It's you.
Amen.
You have to make a choice. And that choice to please God will take you to eternity.
Amen.
Every other choices that we make, I mean, any other choice that you make should be bound by this choice to follow God. Everything should be guided by what God says. May God help you. May God bless you. We are going to have the closing song. May God bless you.
Psalm 119, when he cometh, 17 on our green hymn books.
Apo Jesu anouya kotora barume anutora bakanaka Abo vado muda, vado vate vacere, vacine sitema, vado yenda kudenga, kogama na Jesu, kapo Jesu, anuoya kotura vakazi. Anutura bakanaka abu vanomuda vanu vake vachede vasine sitema vanoyenda kudenga kogama na Jesu apo Jesu Anoya, Kotora, Ba. bathe anotura bakanaka abuva no muda vanu vake jene basine zitema vadoenda kudenga kogara na Jesu.
We shall remain standing to be led in prayer by Brother Temo.
That seems great, Namat. Mwari Baba, Mwari Mwana Komana, Mwari Mwaya Mutsvene. Tinokutendai nekukurumbidzai, Baba, nyasha dzamunotiitira zuva nezuva. Ishe, tinokutendai neprivilege yekuti tinzwe mutauro wenyu. Privilege yekuti tinge tiri pamberi, Ishe wangu peshoko renyu, tichinzwa muchitidzidzisa. Tinorarama, Baba, Ishe upenyu hwatinotora madecisions day in, day out. Ishe matizarura mufungo nemuonero. Kuti tizive kuti Baba, no matter how small a decision it is, we need your counsel. Ishe tibatsirei. Tipei kuzvininipisa. Kuti tizive kuti tega hapana zvatiri. Asi kuti Baba mukatitsigira, Jehovha tinosvika. Tibatsirei Jehovha panyaya yatanzwa mangwanani ano. Yekutora ma godly decisions. Batsirai vakuru, batsirai vana vedu, batsirai Jehovha. Ishe mazvita yenyu tatenda, matirongedzera. Ishe takuenda kudzimba tamuchiedza, takuenda kumabasa tamuchiedza, takunorarama tiri muchiedza. Ishe mazvita yenyu ropafadzai kubudikidza ndiJesu Kristu tenzwe. Amen.